development program, CATHIP Health Hour. The Caribbean and African Health Network, CAHN, along with its national partners, are incredibly pleased to continue to bring to you targeted health and well-being education delivered by Caribbean and African doctors. These health hours are all about empowering, educating, and giving space to Black people so our communities can look after themselves better. Every Saturday, our Black GPs or consultants present on those health and well-being topics that affect you, your family members, and friends. Some weeks will vary and will include other panel members such as pharmacists, specialist nurses, and faith leaders. Our health hours cover a range of topics and include mental health, heart health, women's health, reproductive and sexual health issues, men's health, respiratory problems, cancer, sickle cell, and many more. We have not forgotten to include within our health hours the many societal, cultural, religious, and racial challenges that can go hand in hand with health problems and influence how we should respond to meet health and well-being needs. The sessions are designed for you, and we want you to use the time to listen, learn, share your experiences, and ask questions to our Black doctors. During every session, we will gather your feedback so we can continue to respond to the needs of our Black community. To request any particular topic, please email health@cahn.org.uk. We encourage you to invite others to our health hour sessions. Spread the word in our community. CATHIP is funded by the National Lottery Community Fund.
Hello and good morning to everybody, and welcome to our Health Hour session for today, Saturday the 30th of April. I hope that everyone is hopefully enjoying some degree of warm and nice weather wherever you are. Good to see you all. April has been a really lovely month with lots of topics in various aspects of mental health. And today we have an equally stimulating discussion centered around intellectual disabilities. So we will be having a special resource person today to take us through, and as usual, we'll have the opportunity to ask our questions at the end when we get to the Q&A session. And we would say that people do feel free to pop your questions in the chat box as we go along as well. So as always, we welcome you, and it's a great pleasure to have everyone here today. Now, today we have a consultant psychiatrist who will be taking us through this session. He's been a member of the Royal College of Psychiatrists since about 2013. He's got wealth of experience working with the NHS in private settings and in various settings. And he's currently a consultant psychiatrist at the St. Mary's Hospital in Kettering in Northamptonshire. And his speciality, or his area of specialization, is in intellectual disabilities. We normally say learning disabilities, but we will soon learn that that is not a term we should be using. So I have the honor and the pleasure to introduce to all of us today Dr. Humphrey Enow, who is a consultant psychiatrist, and he will be taking us through this session, and he specializes in intellectual disabilities. Lovely to see you, Dr. Enow. And
yeah, lovely to see you too, Dr. Diana, and thanks for this great opportunity to be with you guys today. So over the next 60 to 90 minutes, we're going to be talking about intellectual disability or learning disability. These two phrases refer to the same condition. Intellectual disability is a preferred phrase, and it is widely used among professionals, but learning disability is still commonly used in the general public. I had a brief conversation with Dr. Diana and Gozzi before we came on live about sort of breach of trust. I had, you know, insisted that, you know, the topic should be titled intellectual disability. And that is because I thought this would be a good opportunity to get the community in line with how this condition is described in mainstream settings. So if there is one thing you're going to take away from this presentation, let it be the fact that the condition that used to be described as learning disability is now referred to as intellectual disability. And that is because we now know that it affects other areas of your intelligence and not just your learning. We've got a lot to cover today. Sorry, I'm just trying to move my slides. How do I move the slide? Some technical issues, let me see. Okay, that's fine. So we've got a lot to cover today, and I'm pretty sure I'm going to just whisk through some of the slides. So we will start with some historical level. So I'm going to describe how this condition was, you know, described, you know, a few years ago. We'll talk about the inclusion criteria. Then I'll discuss the levels of severity of intellectual disability. I'll also talk about how common the condition is in the UK. We'll discuss some common risk factors or causes of this condition. Then we'll discuss conditions that could mimic intellectual disability or that could occur together with intellectual disability, so things like autism, ADHD, cerebral palsy. We'll discuss some therapeutic objectives of this condition. And then I will spend some time to explain the health inequalities between people with intellectual disability and the general population. I'll also talk about some barriers stopping people with intellectual disability from getting good quality healthcare. And if there is time at the end of the presentation, we're going to have a very interactive Q&A. So not so long ago, people with this condition were described in pejorative terms. At one stage, they were called idiots, imbeciles, moron, and even retarded or mentally retarded. And these labels were not just appalling, they were dehumanizing. Dehumanizing because they failed to recognize the distinction between these individuals and their conditions. And no one should be defined by whatever condition they're born with or they're living with. We're all more than our disabilities and infirmities. I'm pretty sure most of you watching me will know someone in your community with intellectual disability who is cherished and valued, not just for who they are, but for the contribution that they bring into the community. So it is only fair that these guys are defined by the different components in their lives and not just by their disability. So more recently, people with this condition are described as people with intellectual disability, which is a more dignified and courteous phrase. And hopefully this change in phrase will also help change how people with intellectual disability are perceived by the public. And because the phrase portrays them in a courteous and dignified way, it may help reduce some of the prejudice and stigma that exists in certain pockets of the society. How do we define intellectual disability? Intellectual disability is defined as limitations in both intellectual functioning and adaptive behavior that originates before your 18th birthday or before 18 years. This definition is used by two of the most widely established psychiatric classification systems in the world, that is the DSM. And the ICD. It is possible to diagnose someone with intellectual disabilities in their 20s, in their 40s, even in their 60s, as long as there is evidence that the onset of their symptoms preceded their 18th birthday. And someone may ask, why 18? Intellectual disability belongs to a group of conditions known as neurodevelopmental disorders. These are conditions in which the growth and development of the brain is affected. And we know that up until your 18th birthday, your brain continues to grow and develop. So if you were to have an injury to your brain after your 18th birthday, even if that injury results in limitation in your intelligence and adaptive behavior, you cannot be diagnosed with intellectual disability. And in the UK, you won't be eligible for support from the intellectual disability services. As a matter of fact, your condition will be described as acquired brain injury, and you're going to be looked after by the neuro rehab team. We're going to take a few minutes to explain the different components in this diagnosis, starting with intellectual functioning. Intellectual functioning is also referred to as intelligence, and it includes the following mental abilities: the ability to learn, whether it's academic learning or experimental learning, ability to plan, organize your day, your life, your time, ability to make informed and sensible judgments, ability to reason things out, ability to problem solve and to think in abstract terms. So all of these different mental functions constitute what is referred to as intelligence. And people with intellectual disability will struggle or will have a limitation with these different mental functions. How do we measure intelligence? Psychologists have figured out a way to measure intelligence, and they use a proxy known as intelligent quotient, which is a number that indicates a person's inherent ability to learn or to learn new and complex information. The high IQ therefore means you have the ability to do well at school. There are a number of different tests that are used to measure someone's intelligence, and they all have to be standardized and they have to be culturally appropriate. And in the UK, we tend to use the Wechsler intelligence scales very commonly. It has an adult version, a children's version, and a preschool version. So far, we have been told that people with intellectual disability will have limitation in the intelligence. And in the previous slide, we were able to define what constitutes intelligence. We were told that psychologists have figured out a way to measure intelligence, and they use a proxy known as IQ or intelligence quotient, which is a number that indicates a person's inherent ability to learn new and complex information. So what then is the IQ number that puts someone within the intellectual disability bracket? Again, psychologists have figured that out, and the number is 70. So if you have an IQ below 70, you're deemed to have limitation in your intelligence as defined by the DSM and the ICD, as defined by those two widely established psychiatric classification bodies I mentioned above. So why 70? The mean IQ in the general population is 100 with a standard deviation of 15. So 70 simply means you have two standard deviations. You have an IQ that is two standard deviations below the mean. The next diagnostic component we're going to just talk about briefly is adaptive behavior. Adaptive behavior refers to everyday conceptual, social, and practical skills. These are skills that enable each and every one of us to cope with our environment. And they include real life skills like grooming, getting dressed, avoiding danger, safe food handling, following rules, managing money, cleaning, making friends, some basic practical social skills, taking responsibility. These are the skills that we all need to get by in life. And people with intellectual disability are going to have limitations in all of these real life skills. And just like IQ, psychologists have been able to figure out how to measure all these different skills. And there are a number of different tools that are used to measure the skills, and they all have to be standardized and they have to be culturally appropriate. And in the UK, the Adaptive Behavior Assessment System, that edition, commonly used. In a subsequent slide, I'll discuss the different levels of intellectual disability. At that stage, I'm going to explain the different IQ ranges and skill sets across the intellectual disability spectrum. So how common is this condition in the UK? About 1.5 people in the UK have got intellectual disability. And about 2.5% of adults in the UK are believed to have intellectual disability. And there is a male-female preponderance, so it tends to affect more males than female, just like all the other neurodevelopmental disorders. And for every female that has the condition, there are 3 males with the condition. What are the different causes of intellectual disability? Or what are the different risk factors that could increase someone's risk of developing intellectual disability? Again, there are more risk factors than can fit into this slide, so this list is by no means exhaustive. I have decided to group the courses into prenatal courses. Perinatal courses, and postnatal courses. So prenatal courses will refer to those events that occur before pregnancy and during pregnancy that could increase your risk of having intellectual disability. Perinatal courses will refer to those events that occur around labor and delivery that will increase your risk of having intellectual disability. And postnatal courses will refer to those events that occur from when you're born to your 18th birthday that increase your risk of intellectual disability. Placental insufficiency is a well-known risk factor of intellectual disability. And this occurs when the placenta doesn't work as well as it should and is unable to deliver enough blood and nutrients, or enough oxygen and nutrients to the fetus. And this can occur in conditions like preeclampsia, diabetes in pregnancy, and many other medical conditions. The fetal brain relies entirely on enough nutrients and oxygen to survive and to grow. And if for any reason there is a shortage of supply of nutrients and oxygen, the brain could get damaged irreparably, which could result in intellectual disability. Another known cause of intellectual disability is maternal ingestion of alcohol during pregnancy, which may result in fetal alcohol syndrome, which include intellectual disability among other conditions. Again, we know that certain drugs, if consumed during pregnancy, may also affect the growth and development of the brain, which may result in intellectual disability. There is a drug that is commonly used to manage epilepsy, it's known as sodium valproate. This is one drug that we know for a fact that can result in intellectual disability as well as other neurodevelopmental disorders. Certain infections when they occur during the first trimester, like varicella, rubella, and toxoplasmosis, could also increase your risk or the baby's risk of developing intellectual disability. Certain genetic conditions and chromosomal disorders can also either cause or increase baby's risk of developing intellectual disability. Among the perinatal risk factors are things like prematurity. This refers to children that are born before 37 weeks gestation. The risk is much higher among the babies that are born just around the age of viability. So around 24, 25, 26, 26 weeks, the risk is much higher compared to those who are born close to 10. Placental abruption is another known risk factor. This refers to a condition where the placenta prematurely separates from the walls of the womb, and this could affect the blood supply to the baby, which may result in an impairment in the brain growth and development. Obstetric trauma is another known risk factor. This could involve or could occur commonly during assisted delivery. Say, for example, a lady is in labor and she's too tired to push out the baby. There isn't enough time for the obstetricians to wait for her to regain her strength, and they need to assist her delivery with, you know, instruments. And the two commonly used instruments that they use to assist with delivery are either the forceps or the ventus, which is a suction device. These are very safe instruments, I must say, that in the hands of an inexperienced obstetrician would cause harm to the baby. Intracranial hemorrhage refers to bleeding into the baby's brain. It may be as a result of obstetric trauma or many other conditions, and they go ahead and result in intellectual disability. Respiratory distress, especially when the baby's lungs are not properly matured, may affect the amount of oxygenation that takes place in the lungs and could also affect how much oxygen goes to the baby's brain. Severe jaundice is another risk factor that may result in intellectual disability. Postnatal causes, that is, causes that could occur after the baby has been born, so things like head injury. This could be accidental or deliberate, as in what used to be described as shaking baby syndrome, which is the abusive head trauma. Infections like encephalitis and meningitis could also result in intellectual disability. Encephalitis refers to infection or inflammation of the brain, whereas meningitis refers to infection or inflammation of the ovaries of the brain. Again, exposure to certain toxins like lead and mercury can also result in intellectual disability. And studies have consistently shown that lack of enough stimulation can also result in delay in the brain growth and development. So how do you investigate someone to arrive at a diagnosis of intellectual disability? Like every medical condition, you want to take a good history where you explore the possibility of the causative factors that we discussed in the previous slide. So you want to find out if there is any personal history of genetic disorder or family history of a genetic or chromosomal disorder. You want to explore events that happened during pregnancy. Was there alcohol ingestion in pregnancy? Was there ingestion of any medications, especially those medications that could affect growth of baby's brain? You want to find out if at any point during the pregnancy, the obstetricians were concerned about the baby's growth, you know, which may indicate some evidence of placental insufficiency. You want to find out if the baby was born at term or if it was born at preterm. You want to explore events around delivery. Was the delivery assisted? Were instruments used? Did the baby require assistance with their breathing? Were they intubated? What you're trying to get at is whether at any point there may have been a reduction in the blood flow or oxygen flow to the baby's brain, which may affect the growth and development of the brain. You do a quick physical examination where you're looking at developmental milestones. These are specific landmarks that the child is supposed to have achieved at specific ages. For example, a child at 4 months should be able to hold their head steady and have good leg control. A child at 9 months should be able to sit upright. If these milestones are delayed, then you will be having concerns about possibility of brain development. You want to do a mental state examination where you comment about the overall demeanor of the child. You look at evidence of any stereotypic behaviors or mannerism, which would indicate the presence of some neurological disorders. You want to do your routine blood and urine tests where you're looking for possible treatable conditions that may result in intellectual disability. Of course, you do an EEG, which is to exclude the possibility of any seizures. You do chromosomal studies and you do some brain imaging. There are certain conditions that you should be very mindful of before you go ahead and diagnose someone with intellectual disability. These conditions mimic intellectual disability. So things like deaf and dumb, deprived children, isolated speech defects, some psychiatric disorders, and epilepsy. What are the different levels of intellectual disability? There are 4 main levels of intellectual disability: mild, moderate, severe, and profound. And majority of those with intellectual disability will have a mild condition, about 85%. 10% will have a moderate condition, and 5% will have severe and profound condition. So if you have a mild condition, you're going to have an IQ range of somewhere between 50 and 69, and you may be able to live independently. You may be able to gain employment in mainstream settings. You may have rich relationships. You may be able to read and write. You may have some budgeting skills that may have some subtle difficulties understanding social rules. If you have a moderate condition, you'll have an IQ range of somewhere between 35 and 49. Your comprehension will be limited. You may need help with planning and organizing your life. You may need support with your personal care and budgeting. You may need prompts with your hygiene, and we need support with your relationships. people with severe and profound condition tend to have more complex needs. And that is due in part to their very low mental age, and also because they tend to have multiple other conditions alongside their intellectual disability. For example, 6 out of 10 individuals with severe and profound intellectual disability will have epilepsy. And more often than not, their seizures are extremely difficult to treat. They could have multiple seizures in a day sometimes. And sometimes they may require up to 4 different anti-epileptic medications to get their seizures under control. People within the profound and severe spectrum will also have conditions like cerebral palsy, which could affect their movement, their posture, their balance. They may have autism alongside other sensory integration difficulties. They may have multiple psychiatric disorders, from depression, anxiety. They may also have some physical health conditions, underactive thyroid, recurring respiratory infections, and more. So it is no surprise, therefore, that most people with a severe and profound condition will have continuous and intensive help with sometimes all aspects of their life. Some of them will be doubly incontinent, so they have no control of their bowel and bladder. That has infection control ramifications. Some of them will be unable to eat and drink. They need to be fed through a tube in their tummy. Some of them cannot walk and need to be hoisted on transfer. Some of them have no speech and will require adaptive communication measures like marketing and legs. Some of them will also have problems with their vision and hearing. The picture I've just painted is worst case scenario. Of course, there will be those who do not have epilepsy, those who do not have cerebral palsy. But the message is that those with severe and profound condition will obviously have more complex needs than those with mild and moderate condition. And I forgot to add, some of them will be on polypharmacy, some of them will be on like 14 different medications for all the conditions that they've got. Some of these medications have got very serious side effect profiles, and some of these medications will be interacting with each other, which will be very unpleasant with these guys. People with intellectual disability sometimes express themselves in behaviors that could be challenging. And these may be in response to changes in the environment, changes in their relationships, changes in their routine, maybe a way to express frustration or discomfort, and maybe due to some physical illnesses. And these challenging behaviors could range from disruptive behaviors such as swearing, screaming, refusing to follow instructions, may also include some level of violence and unsafe behaviors such as head banging, kicking, biting, punching, fighting, running away, smashing equipment, damaging property. It may also include inappropriate social behavior, such as inappropriate conversations, stealing, being over familiar or over affectionate with strangers, and inappropriate touching, sometimes masturbation in communal or public areas. Some of these behaviors may put these individuals in harm's way or put their carers in harm's way. And occasionally, they may require certain restrictive measures to keep them safe. And this could include things like having to restrain them, physical restraint, where you put your hands on them for a little while until they're coming off, where you use medications to keep them safe. And sometimes they may need to be managed away from others, either in isolation or in seclusion. Some of you may be familiar with the BBC Panorama documentary a few years ago on Winterbourne View Hospital in Gloucestershire, where people with intellectual disability were subject to harrowing experiences by their carers. Because of that, most intellectual disability settings in the UK have moved away from the use of these restrictive practices. So they would rather focus on behavioral strategies, and they only use these restrictive practices as a last resort. And most services will audit themselves constantly to ensure that whenever these restrictive practices have been used, whenever patients have been restrained, or whenever they've been put in isolation, that it was proportionate to the degree of harm that they were trying to prevent, it was justifiable, it was in the patient's best interest, and it was the least restrictive measures available at the time. So most CBDs are, you know, quite strict on the use of these restrictive practices. Earlier on in the presentation, I did mention the fact that intellectual disability belongs to a group of conditions known as neurodevelopmental disorders. And I went ahead to say these are conditions in which the growth and development of the brain is affected. So these include conditions like autism, cerebral palsy, ADHD, and those hills of other conditions. The essence of this slide is to highlight the fact that there is a very close association between the different neurodevelopmental disorders. As you can see, up to a third of those with intellectual disability will have autism. And there's some studies that will show that up to about 60% of those with autism will have intellectual disability, and up to about maybe 30% of those with ADHD will have intellectual disability. So as clinicians and carers, it's important we're mindful of the fact that if someone presents to us with one of these neurodevelopmental disorders, there is the possibility that they may have other undiagnosed neurodevelopmental disorders. So someone presents to you with intellectual disability, for example, there's a possibility that they may have other undiagnosed cerebral palsy, ADHD, or even autism. And it is possible for someone to have all of these conditions. I've got patients who've got, you know, intellectual disability, they've got autism, ADHD, and other neurodevelopmental disorders. And as clinicians, I think what we should be paying attention to is the clinical features. If for any reason patients present with symptoms that meet any of these diagnosis criteria, it's important you go ahead and give them a diagnosis, because that is going to open the doors for them for the support that they need. So what are some of the therapeutic objectives for people with intellectual disability? Intellectual disability has got no cure. It is not treatable. The aim of these objectives is to increase the quality of life of people with this condition. And it includes things like early detection and treatment for conditions that are treatable, things like underactive thyroid, which may go ahead and affect its brain development, or things like phenylketonuria, which can be treated easily with phenylalanine low diet. Other therapeutic objectives include things like health promotion, which is what we're doing here, genetic counseling, good perinatal care. If you recall, when we discussed the causative factors, there were a number of conditions that could occur during pregnancy and during labor and delivery that could increase the child's risk of developing intellectual disability. So it is only fair that if we are able to get good perinatal services, we're going to reduce that risk. Early recognition, diagnosis, and rehabilitation. The recognition, diagnosis, and rehabilitation is provided by a team of different professionals, from speech and language therapists, occupational therapists, psychologists, psychiatry, nurses, physiotherapists, social workers, support workers, and more. I'll just briefly explain the different roles of these professionals. So speech and language therapies will help with communication assessment. If you recall, some of these guys will have difficulty communicating their needs. So speech and language therapies will assist in understanding their level of communication and provide guidelines to carers on how to communicate with these guys. Speech and language therapies will also do swallowing assessments. Some of these guys have difficulty swallowing, and they are at high risk of choking or aspiration. So speech and language therapists will also carry out swallowing assessment, advice on swallowing guidelines. Occupational therapies will advise on modifications that can be carried out within the environment to maximize their functioning. They can also carry out sensory assessments. Some of these guys have got sensory integration difficulties, and OTs will advise on how these difficulties can be managed, either with a sensory diet or sensory-based activities. Psychology is involved in behavior management, try to understand the functions of their behaviors and provide guidelines on how we can support these patients with their behaviors. Psychiatry, which is where I come in, we involve in diagnosis and treatment. We look into other the possibility of other psychiatric conditions, and we also, more often than not, liaise very closely with the other professionals, and we tend to coordinate the care. Nurses, of course, you know what their roles will be. They work closely with the psychologist, either with regards to behavior assessment or with the psychiatrist, regards to understanding if there is any underlying mental illness. Physiotherapy, some of these guys have got problems with their mobility, their posture, their balance, their coordination. The physios will, you know, step in to assist them with these difficulties. Social workers will be involved in needs assessment, funding, and benefits. Support workers will help them with their daily living skills and social prescribing. Another therapeutic objective is integrating people with intellectual disability in the wider society to reduce stigma and discrimination. Adequate treatment of behavioral problems or other psychiatric disorders, I've covered this in the previous slide. Family support. And if you recall, some of these guys will have very complex needs, and sometimes it is in their best interest to be looked after in specialist residential homes. Advocacy is a very important component in the therapeutic objective. Most of these guys cannot advocate for themselves, and they depend on all of us to speak on their behalf. So recently, there is this Trump agenda, which is about reducing the prescription of psychotropic medications in patients with intellectual disability. A few years ago, there was a tendency to rely exclusively on medications to manage challenging behaviors. Where Storm comes in is to get clinicians to have a rethink in how behaviors are managed. So now there's a focus towards behavior management and less so towards medication. We know that these medications have a serious side effect profile and can even reduce the life expectancy of these patients. Also making sure that the right legislations are in place to support the sites, so things like the Disability and Equality Act of 2010, which makes it unlawful to dismiss someone from their work because of their disability, things like the CARE Act, which sets out how social care is run in England to meet the needs of those who need care and support, things like the Mental Capacity Act, Mental Health Act, and those. There's a few legislation that are around to safeguard people with intellectual disability. We know that there are huge health inequalities between people with intellectual disability and the general public. And these health inequalities cut across, you know, physical and mental health. And this is the result of the health inequalities. On average, the life expectancy of a woman with intellectual disability is 18 years shorter than that for other women in the general population. And for men, it is 14 years shorter than men in the general population. So this is quite alarming. And we should be trying to see what we could do to reverse this trend. These are some of the very common conditions that people with intellectual disability grapple with on a regular basis. So constipation is very common, poor vision, poor hearing is common, poor dentition is common, obesity, early onset dementia, especially those of them with Down syndrome, thyroid and respiratory problems, diabetes is common. We also know that people with intellectual disability are less likely to receive screening for breast, cervical, and colorectal cancers compared to the general population. We know that people with intellectual disability, about 54% of them will have other mental health problems, ranging from anxiety, depression, schizophrenia, other forms of psychosis, PTSD, social phobia, specific phobias, and even OCD. These are some of the common barriers stopping people with intellectual disability from getting quality healthcare. And they include things like staff not having enough understanding about intellectual disability, failure to recognize that a person with intellectual disability is unwell, failure to make correct diagnosis, patients not being identified as having intellectual disability, anxiety or lack of confidence for people with intellectual disability, lack of joint working among different professionals and care providers, not enough involvement allowed from carers, and inadequate aftercare or follow-up care. It is recommended that everyone with intellectual disability should be registered with the GP Intellectual Disability Register. There are a lot of GPs in the house. Dr. Diana is one of them. And GP surgeries keep registered with disability. And these are some of the advantages that you will get if you are registered in the GP Intellectual Disability Register. All professionals involved in your care will be expected to make reasonable adjustments in your care and support. I'm going to explain what that means in the next slide. Once you're on the GP Intellectual Disability Register, you will be entitled to have annual physical health checks. So once in a year, you go to your doctor, you have your blood pressure, your weight done, waist circumference, you have your routine blood tests as well. And this will also give you the opportunity to avail yourself with the different cancer screenings. If you're registered with the GP surgery, intellectual disability register, you're also on the priority list for immunizations, as was the case during the COVID pandemic. And also being on the register also facilitates your benefit claims, whether it's your personal independent payment, universal credit, carers allowance. If you're on the register, it opens doors for you to receive these different benefits. In the previous slide, I mentioned that patients who are on the GP intellectual disability register will be entitled to reasonable adjustments in their care support. So within the NHS, these are some of the reasonable adjustments that we could do, making sure that there is wheelchair access in GP surgeries and hospitals, providing easy read materials to patients, whether it's for women letters or procedures. Sometimes we do also provide social stories to help enhance their understanding on whatever procedure or whatever medical intervention we try to provide. Giving someone a priority appointment if they find it difficult waiting in the GP surgery or hospital, longer appointment times if someone needs more time with the doctor or the nurse to make sure you understand the information that is given. So everything I've shared with you guys is widely available on the internet. And for those of you who are interested to read more, I've put together some links that you could click on. Thank you very much for listening and thanks for having me.
Thank you so much. I just put my video back on. Thank you so much. That was a wonderful and in-depth presentation on intellectual disabilities. I'm going to remember to use the right terminology all the time, intellectual disabilities. So we've said that people should please put your questions in the chat box. So that we can adequately address these questions and make sure that everyone's sort of questions or concerns are heard. Dr. Enow, that was really good. So just sort of briefly, you've talked to us about intellectual disabilities today as being part of neurodevelopmental disorders and the fact that it's just one of many. Early recognition is important because then people can get the necessary help and support that they need. It's also interesting you mentioned about how, fairly common it can be relatively. I mean, it's obviously not the commonest thing, but it is fairly prevalent in the society. And we need to be aware of these things so that people can get the right help that they need. And the factors that lead to it could be before, prenatal or during or after birth. And so we need to be on the lookout for whatever might be a risk factor, manage these things adequately to minimize the risk where we can. Some things you can't do much about. The fact that people with intellectual disabilities can have other neurodevelopmental conditions as well. Now, just as we wait for the questions to come in, thank you once again, but I do have a few for you to start off with. So the first thing that I'd like to ask is whether stress can lead to or be a cause of intellectual disability. And then also secondly, when we look at the causes that you told us about today, some of the things we probably can't do that much about, but there are things that we can do a lot about. And it's always useful when we can focus on what we can do something about. So in your expert opinion, what are some of the things that we can do something about? And what are some of those measures that we can take to minimize the risk or prevent the prevalence or, you know, prevent people getting these disorders where possible? Thank you.
So starting with whether stress could increase your risk of having a baby with intellectual disability?
Yes.
I think that would be a stretch, but stress can affect your immunity. And we mentioned that there are a number of medical conditions that could lead to placental insufficiency. So that is the association I'm going to allude to, but I think it would be a real stretch. I don't think I have any evidence to point to a direct link between stress and intellectual disability, but it's possible if, you know, the stress is to the extent that, you know, it compromises your immunity, increases your risk of some of those conditions that we mentioned that could result in placental insufficiency. And the second question is on whether on things that we could do. Again, something as simple as don't drink while you're pregnant. You know, something as simple as that, you know, could go a long way. And I know the risk is higher during the first trimester, but again, there's also evidence that drinking at any gestation age could increase the risk of fetal alcohol syndrome. So avoid alcohol as much as you can, something as simple as that. When you're pregnant, be very mindful of what medications you take. You know, speak to your doctor and speak to your psychiatrist if you're on many other medications, psychiatric medications. The changes they could make, some medications are safer in pregnancy, some are not. Okay. Those are some of the common things we could do. And then good obstetric care is very important. You know, make sure your baby is growing as expected. If that is not the case, you know, see your obstetrician and they'll support you and they'll intervene at the right time and so on and so forth. Then postnatal care, stimulation is very, very important. Just make sure that your baby is growing in an environment where there's a lot of stimulation that stretches the synapses and increases brain development as well. So there are a lot of things we could do to minimize or mitigate, you know, the risk of intellectual disability.
Can you touch a little bit more on the stimulation? So on a practical level, what sorts of things referring to? Sorry, can you hear me?
So
sorry, I think there's a bit of a glitch in the line. Can you hear me, Dr. Humphrey?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yes, carry on, please. Carry on.
So the studies that were done that showed the link between lack of sociocultural stimulation and brain development were done in harrowing conditions. These were kids that were, you know, that were abandoned and didn't have enough support around them. Yeah, so I'm sure that, you know, as long as you have the right sort of parental care around you, as long as you have the right nurturing, loving environment, that is good enough. But in adverse situation where you've been abandoned and, you know, you're not being looked after, not being nurtured properly, that could have a negative effect on the growth and development of the brain. Okay, I'm sure most of us will be doing okay. Just make sure that, you know, you're responsive to your child, you know, you're sensitive to their needs, you know, and pick on cues and go along with the cues. I'm sure most of us as parents do that already.
Yeah. So it's important that we create those stimulating environments for the children and also for ourselves during pregnancy or even before or at whatever level that we find ourselves. Thank you for answering that. There's another question which relates to race. So actually a few questions relating to race, asking whether there's any particular prevalence in any certain or specific races or whether there's any preponderance to a certain race being more predisposed than others. So anything in relation to race and intellectual disabilities, please.
I'm not aware of any studies that have looked into any racial preponderance for the conditions. I don't have the facts to see whether it affects, you know, any particular racial group or ethnic group more than the other. I'm afraid I don't have that fact. But again, I think there might be a perception that this condition is commoner in Western world, and that is because of the advancement of healthcare. So, you know, in the UK, as you know, the age of viability is 24, and the babies who survive, you know, sometimes 25 weeks, you know, 26 weeks, and the lower the gestational age, the more likely you're going to end up with some of these, you know, neurodevelopmental conditions, including intellectual disability. And I think in other parts of the world, in probably less developed countries, you know, most babies will not survive. They don't have the services, you know, to look after them at that age. So there is a sort of natural selection and that may create the false impression, you know, that, you know, these conditions are more prevalent among, say, Caucasian, you know, communities. But that is just because these societies are so advanced that, you know, they will, you know, make sure that even children who are born at very gestational age, very low gestational age survives. You know, I think that is it. But to answer the question, I'm not aware of any ethnic or racial preponderance of the condition.
Thank you. Thank you. And I'm sure that if we also look back from when some of us would have, you know, trained in Africa or other parts of the world, it, as you've rightly said, it probably wasn't that easily diagnosed. So a lot of people might go undiagnosed or it might be put to other causes when actually they haven't really received the right diagnosis. So it comes across as though the Caucasians have it more, but maybe whether we're not actually diagnosing it in less fortunate countries as well. Yeah, so there's also a question, Dr. Enow, or more of a comment, but something I'd like you to contribute to, please. So someone says the term learning disability, which we would now be saying intellectual disability. So as Dr. Enow said, if you leave here today with nothing at all, leave remembering that it's intellectual disability, not learning disability. So the term learning disability is difficult because some children achieve 8 GCSEs and studying for A-levels by school structure cannot cope with behavior, so they receive little support. I don't know what you have to say about that. That's someone's comment.
Can you repeat that again, Dr. Diane?
So I think what she's trying to say is that because some children sort of struggle when it comes to doing their exams and all of that, because of the school structure, they're not able to cope properly with their behavior. They end up receiving learning support. But whether the person is trying to say that the term learning disability sort of puts them in a box, or whether she's saying there isn't enough support available. I think we can probably break it into two. So what do we do where we think people might have a problem, but they haven't received a diagnosis and there's no support? And what do we do with people who have a diagnosis but not getting adequate support? So if you can tackle those for us, please.
I think within the school systems, there are processes in place to support kids with their academic needs, and most schools will have a special education needs coordinator, SENCO, and teachers are trained in, you know, identifying children who may be struggling, and they will make the referral, and the SENCOs would, you know, take a lead on that, and if they think there is need for maybe further assessment, whether from psychology or psychiatrists, they will do the referral. But I think something I should say as well is that what we're not talking about is learning difficulties. So there is a difference between learning disabilities and learning difficulties. Learning difficulties refer to difficulties in specific areas of learning. So things like dyslexia, we have difficulties reading and spelling, or things like dyscalculia, difficulties with basic arithmetic skills, or things like dysgraphia, difficulty writing. So within the school settings, you know, you tend to see learning difficulty more. And even within that setting, there are systems in place to support them. So I didn't quite get what the question was, but there's a distinction between learning difficulties and learning disabilities. Learning disabilities or intellectual disabilities tend to affect other aspects of your life and your brain generally, but learning difficulties is just limited to specific areas of learning. So more often than not, I think it was Nadine Doris who recently, you know, misspoke, and she said she got dyslexia. They say she's functioning really well. So that is a specific learning difficulty, you know, just, you know, limiting her on a specific area of learning and doesn't affect her brain.
Thanks for making that important distinction for us. Thank you. There's another question here, a bit of a long one, but I'll read it through. So my son has autism and he has ADHD. He was premature and born at 2 pounds from abrupt placenta. His autism was said not to be over the threshold. However, the traits are strong. They only went for the ADHD as he was scoring high. This was despite professionals stating he had autism. I put some strategies in place which do not seem... I have put so much strategies which do not make him seem like a very autistic, an average autistic child. What do I do? So I guess it's something to do with diagnosis and not a consensus on diagnosing and what happened. So we can make that a bit more generic so that it benefits everyone. If there isn't a consensus on diagnosis, or if a parent or ward thinks that they're ward has some diagnosis and the professionals think otherwise, what can people do in such an instance? Thank you.
I used to work in an autism diagnostic service, and sometimes parents don't agree with the clinical impression, and it is within their right. So if you think your child, you know, has significant traits that, you know, meets the threshold, and you're reviewed by a diagnostic service and you're disappointed because you've been told the child doesn't meet the criteria, you could escalate it. So you could write and say you don't agree, and most services will have processes in place to redress that. You know, you may be assigned a different clinician to have a second look. I don't know what diagnostic tools that was used to screen your child before they came to the conclusion that he doesn't have autism. I don't know whether it was done on clinical grounds or whether he was subject to any of the formal diagnostic assessment. But if you strongly believe that he's got autism, no matter the age, you can escalate it within the services, and somebody else will have a look and decide whether he meets the criteria or not.
Thank you. So second opinions can be sought. Thank you. There's also a question which you probably answered, but someone would like you to throw a bit more light on. So a specific case about a lady who was drinking in pregnancy, had some medications, baby abandoned in Skibu, baby ended up in the care system. She's asking, is this baby or this child at risk of issues like ADHD, for instance?
So the answer is yes. Yeah, I like the way she phrased it, at risk. There's no guarantee. Mm-hmm. You know, the child may turn out to be pretty okay, pretty fine, but maybe it's at risk, given all the risk factors that, you know, you mentioned in the question.
Thank you. Again, I'm sorry, we do have quite a few questions for you. It's been a wonderful discussion, so it's generating a lot of questions. So there's also another case scenario about a son who's 16 years, has experienced parental alienation, and it predicted to have low GCSE grades. He got extra time for his exams, but he finds it difficult because of dyslexia. Are there any tips over the next few years that can help? So any tips that can be useful, or maybe any information that you can send across or tell us about?
We could get some resources and share with her. You know, but I would advise that if the child has been formally diagnosed with dyslexia, there are services available to support children with dyslexia. So she should be able to, you know, go through the system, either from the GP or from the school. But I'll see what we've got within, you know, within our services and see what I can share with her.
Thank you. And remember that the CAHN email is also available. If you want further information, you can send your questions there as well. Or if you want specific information on some of these areas, you can email. It will be put in the chat box so that people can get that information. Right, so there was another question along the themes of risk factors for HDAD, but I think you have answered that already because there was a similar question. Now, there's another question. Well, more of a statement, she says. So thank you, Dr. Eno, that the commenter says, not a question, but a statement. The social model of disability posits people face barriers in society and the minds of others are opposed to them lacking normal or typical behaviors. As a MHP speaking to wonderful autistic young person yesterday, he told me he prefers the term different ability. He prefers the term different ability as opposed to disabled. This to me centers individual uniqueness, agency, and self-esteem. A much more empowering term, I think. So this is someone sharing an opinion about what she thinks, and she'd want your take on it as well.
I think we started the presentation with some historical labels, didn't we?
Yes.
From some very pejorative labels. And we're at the stage where, you know, we sort of comfortable with the phrase intellectual disability. But I still think, you know, diagnostic labels evolve over time. I'm sure maybe at some point there might be a rethink. You know, so the idea of different abilities is something that may creep into the description in the future. And we're now in a system where the policies are patient-led and services-led. So I'm sure that if the service users and the patients feel more empowered with the different phrases to describe them, I'm sure that is something that may come up in the future and it might change. And on this particular issue, I'm pretty sure that, you know, this particular individual who feels so strongly about the word disability, he shouldn't be referred to, you know, with that phrase. So those working with him, those working around him, should empower him and go along with what he's suggesting.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure, you know, in the future, this could be something that, you know, gets traction and might lead to a change in the overall phrasing of how we describe this condition.
Absolutely, yes, thank you. Thank you for that. If you have dyslexia and dyspraxia, does that make your brain slower? Because some people's understanding is that it might make your brain slow, or is that normal? Is there anything that can be done about it at all?
Again, I want to create a distinction between the learning difficulties and learning disability. So learning disabilities affect your brain generally and affects other aspects of your life. But learning difficulties like dyslexia, they're just limited to specific areas of learning. So it doesn't, well, the question was whether it affects other areas of your life. Was that the question?
Yes, whether it is normal or whether it indicates that your brain is slower than, you know, it should be.
I don't want to use the phrase the brain is slower. I don't want to go with that. I'll just stick to what I said, that you have specific difficulties in certain areas of learning, and that difficulty is limited to that area of learning. And in other aspects, your brain should be just as good as the general population.
Thank you. Thank you. Another question in relation to the causative or risk factors. So you spoke about the fact that during pregnancy, so I'll read it as it is. So the conditions that the doctor spoke about during pregnancy are very prevalent. So for instance, preeclampsia, preterm birth among Black women. So on that basis, could we conclude that there might be a higher propensity towards intellectual disability? So I think it's just going back to the earlier discussion about whether there was any sort of preponderance in a particular race. And as you've said, there is no strong study to support that. But someone is drawing an inference to say that because we tend to have preterm births, preeclampsia, etc., quite common among Black women, could that therefore mean that we are more at risk or more prone? So I'll leave that ball in your court just to sort of re-emphasize what you want to in this area. Thank you.
So these are risk factors. So what I'm not saying is that every preterm baby is going to develop intellectual disability, or every pregnancy that was complicated by preeclampsia will result in the baby with intellectual disability. So these are risk factors. And obstetricians are very much aware of the complications of these conditions. And that's more reason why once you're pregnant and you're diagnosed with any of these conditions, they don't tend to monitor you very closely. And they monitor the baby's growth and other aspects of well-being of the baby. And if at any point they're concerned that they may compromise the baby's well-being, will be offered, you know, a delivery. Yeah. So just to reassure the lady that these are risk factors, it doesn't guarantee that, you know, your child will develop, you know, intellectual disability if you have a preterm baby or if you're diagnosed with preeclampsia in the pregnancy.
Thank you for that assurance. Yes, and I think it's important that we have that distinction to know that not everyone who necessarily has a complicated pregnancy will end up with, you know, a child. He's just saying they're risk factors. He's not saying they're exactly going to cause it. Thanks for that. Now, two questions. One about immunization. Can certain or do certain immunizations lead to intellectual disability? And secondly, specifically, is there any link with COVID that you are aware of? Obviously, with the pandemic, we people worry about a lot of things relating to COVID. So has there been any link established or any link between COVID and the development of any intellectual disability?
I'm not aware of any such link. I'm sure, you know, it may come up in the future, but at this stage, I'm not aware of any such thing. And the first question about immunization. Mm-hmm. If you recall, when I was going through the causative or risk factors, I mentioned certain infections that could occur during pregnancy, rubella, toxoplasmosis, varicella. So these are all, you know, common viral conditions that most women are immune against. So if anything, immunization prevents you from having those conditions. So it's important that, you know, as a community, we all encourage, you know, our children, mothers to get the right immunizations, because these immunizations could prevent things like that, which I mentioned in the first, which I mentioned in one of the previous slides.
Thanks for that. So it's important that we do everything we can, including getting immunized where we're eligible for, to prevent these things. And I know that there are concerns about immunization, but basically what our consultant is also reassuring us about is the fact that we are rather preventing rather than exposing ourselves to some of these conditions. Now, the healthy choices that you talked about, the things that we can do, someone would like you to go through those again. So some of the healthy life choices or some of the healthy lifestyles or specific health or lifestyle changes that we can sort of engage with to minimize our risks where possible relating to intellectual disabilities. If you could kindly go through that again, one of our listeners.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think this is not going to be unique to intellectual disability. It cuts across, you know, every, you know, medical condition. So I'm sure Dr. Diane, you probably a better position to explain on lifestyle choices than myself. But basically things like, you know, you don't go wrong with a healthy diet. You don't go wrong with, you know, regular exercise. You know, you don't go wrong with, you know, seeking early medical, you know, attention if, you know, you're worried about something. You don't have to hold on until things get worse before you seek help. So some, you know, simple things like that could go a long way. And within our community, I think there is always alternative theories to some of these conditions. You know, of course, from our religious and, you know, cultural, you know, inclinations, you know, someone with intellectual disability, we may have more than one possible hypothesis. You know, we may attribute the cause to some other factors, religious or cultural factors. So I think, you know, I believe that I'm a Christian, and I believe that, you know, they could go, you know, together. So while you're trying to explore the other alternative courses, please make sure you engage with, you know, the services. The services are there. They've been tested and proven, and they work. They work better than, you know, every church you could go to. They work better than every spiritual leader you could go to. They have many years of experience supporting people with intellectual disability, and we should, you know, take advantage. Being in the UK is a blessing. I know there is a sense of mistrust between most minority communities and the institutions. I guess that mistrust comes from the fact that people don't feel represented, and they worry that, you know, their interests may not be looked after. But I can assure you all that, you know, I have been in the system for so long. People who work in the system don't look at your race, extremely professional, and they take a lot of pride in making sure that they can make a difference in your life and the life of your children. So we should engage with the system. And if we don't feel like our needs have been met, there's systems in place that we could challenge, we could make a complaint. And I've reviewed complaints have been made against me. And these are issues that are taken seriously. Yeah, so I think we should count ourselves lucky to be in a system where, in a place where we have the sort of services that we have. And it breaks my heart sometimes that, you know, ethnic minorities, we don't really engage with the system. One of the best care package I've wrapped around has been to an Afro-Caribbean child. And I've got multidisciplinary team of professionals working around him, and none of them even see the skin color. You know, they also focus on making sure that, you know, we can make a difference in his quality of life. So if there is one thing we should take from this talk, is that I understand the mistrust between, well, from most of us with the system. And I think the system has to do more as well, because the more you see people who look like you somewhere, the more you're going to trust the system. So they should do more to put, you know, people like you and I in positions where they can influence decisions about us, because that is how we can build trust in the system. But that said, the system is good enough. And if we engage with the system, it works.
Thank you so much for that very powerful message. Thank you. Now, we've got quite a few more questions coming up, so I'll bunch a few together for you. So just on the sort of cultural dimension, quickly, someone would like to know whether intermarriages between relationships or close family members can increase the risk of intellectual disability sort of being propagated. So that's the first thing. And then just slightly on the bit of, I think it's following on from the discussion about dyslexia and whether it slows the brain, which you've said, no, there's no evidence for that. But someone is citing a case where someone's daughter was being stopped from going to university because apparently that they have a slow brain problem, and therefore they don't want them to go to university. The child says, no, actually, I believe I can do this. I want to go. And it's creating a bit of conflict. So she's asking, what would you advise? A bit of your counseling hat, I guess.
Definitely. So someone wants to go to university, and the advice in high gains, because
they're saying you've got a slow brain, you know, you've got a slow brain problem.
That's really, really weird, don't you think? I mean, who would advise her against? If she's able to cope in university settings, then she should be encouraged to And I don't really know what, I can't comment on what a slow brain is. I don't think it's a medical phrase, so I don't really know what it means.
I'm sure the person can probably send some further information if we want to delve into this a bit deeper and then maybe pick it up and pass it on.
Yeah, and not stop someone with dyslexia from having other neurological or maybe other neurodevelopmental disorders. So what I'm saying is dyslexia on its own doesn't affect, you know, the brain generally speaking. It's limited to specific areas of learning. But again, you can have dyslexia and other conditions that can affect your brain. So that distinction should be made.
Okay. How do people get tested? How do they get help? Very briefly, if someone thinks they are dyslexic, because we've had quite a few questions on dyslexia.
Yeah.
So if they feel they are, or your manager thinks, oh, actually, no, they're assuming you are, or they've labeled you without you having any formal testing. How do people get tested? Very briefly, please.
I think most of the support is provided by psychologists. So as psychiatrists, we don't really directly involve in management of dyslexia. Most of the support and strategies would be psychology-led. So I'm sure if you think, you know, you may have dyslexia, you see your GP. If you're within the school settings, I'm sure there are processes within school settings to support someone with dyslexia. The psychiatry is not an area where we directly involve. Because like I said, it's limited to specific areas of learning, and we're more involved with, you know, conditions that affect, you know, generalization of the brain.
Yeah. Okay. And I'm sure that if you're not sure where to go, seeing your GP is always a very good first point of call. And then they can refer you on or signpost you to the right services as well.
Your first question was on consanguineous marriages, right?
Consanguineous marriages, yes, please. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's fine. So that if there is a genetic or chromosomal conditions within the family, and you marry within the family, then it's very likely that, you know, you're going to pass on the gene, and that increases the risk. If that particular gene predisposes your child to intellectual disability, then of course, you know, it would increase the risk. So marrying within the family, if there's family history of a particular genetic disorder or chromosomal disorder, that increases the risk of intellectual disability. If you marry within the family, you're more likely pass on that gene to your offspring, and if you had married someone who doesn't have the same gene.
Thanks for that. Now there is another question which is relating to the mistrust issue, which we sort of talked about briefly, and it's centered around the fact that if we know that there are these issues of mistrust in the system, and therefore people may not always be accessing or seeking help when they should, what can we do to sort of minimize this? Because we know that people from ethnic minority they're less likely to sort of come forward. The phrasing is more along the lines of the system isn't set up to do more, you know, for ethnic minorities, but I guess essentially the message is that how can we sort of do more to build up trust to encourage people more to access help which is available. So in your opinion, what can we do? Thank you.
I think it is a two-way stream. So the mistrust is partly because of lack of representation. It is very difficult to have confidence in a system that you don't feel you're represented in the system. So if you feel that, you know, the organization or the system doesn't look after your interest, then you're not going to trust it. Mm-hmm. And one of the ways that you can trust the system is when you feel you're represented in positions that matter. So I know that oftentimes the onus is put on the communities and say, why don't you guys engage more? But I think the system has to do more as well to inspire that trust, inspire that confidence. So it's a two-way street. On our part, what I'm saying is that the mistrust is not based on fact. Because if you engage with the system, the care that you're going to get will just be as good as someone from a native, you know, population or someone from any other ethnic background. I mean, you will know this, Dr. Diana, you know, you've worked across different services in the UK, and color, as a matter of fact, services take pride in being inclusive. They take pride in making cultural, religious adjustments for their services.
Yeah.
So I think if we just go past that perception and engage with the system, engage wholeheartedly, we'll realize that it's not as bad as we think.
Yeah. And that's true. We can do something about what we can do something about. So as much as it might be bleak, we still need to engage as much as we can. There is help available. I realize
And sometimes when we don't engage wholeheartedly. And that sometimes makes it difficult for professionals, you know, to engage or to give you their best. Okay. So we should trust the system and give it our all. And if you think your needs have not been met, you can make a complaint and it is taken seriously. Most complaints are signed off by the chief executives. So they're not dealt with at a local level.
Yeah.
And I've been involved, I've reviewed complaints have been made against me, and I know how serious the process is taken. So let's engage with the system and go past the mistrust.
That's a powerful note to end on. And on that note, I've just looked at the time. It was so exciting. I'd taken my eyes off the time and I've just realized it's 20 past 12. So on that note, I would want to say a massive, massive thank you to you, Dr. Enow. It's been a very insightful discussion, very informative. Excellent slides, which can be made available, information made available to people who want it. If you send an email to the CAHN email, which will be put in the box, or if you contact any of the admin team. There are lots of services available as well, which we will be notified about, so that if people need help in other areas, I had a few messages about people struggling with their mental health and they would want help. I've also had a few messages about people who want some counselling support for other area. So all these facilities are available as well, which CAHN can help with. If there's anything we've not been able to address today, my massive apologies. Please send an email and we'll get back to you. It's been a great discussion. So obviously a lot of information has come through. But no, we want to say thank you so much, Dr. Humphrey Enow, consultant psychiatrist, who's come all the way to talk to us today. And I'm sure we'll see you again another time. It's been wonderful and we're really grateful. Thank you so much, and over to the team.
Right, thank you, Dr. Diana. Massive thanks to Dr. Humphrey for this informative session on intellectual disabilities, and to you, Dr. Diana, for chairing this or hosting our health hour session. A big thank you to all our CATHIP partners and to all our attendees on Zoom, Facebook, and YouTube. You can also access Dr. Humphrey's slides for today's session by emailing health@cahn.org.uk. For further information about our upcoming event, please see in the chat box. Please note, our Healthy Heart session is back on every Tuesday evening from 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. Our Windrush Day, this is happening live on the 25th of June at the Alexandra Park, Manchester. Please make it a point or a day to be part of this great event. If you have not booked your place for this event, please do so by visiting our website or see in the chat box for further information. Please book your place for the suicide awareness workshop, which is happening on Friday, the 13th of May, from 9:30 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. For further details, please see that in the chat box. Also visit our website or see that in the chat box for more information about our mental health services. We are back again next Saturday with the same link, and the topic is the link between diabetes, high blood pressure, and chronic kidney disease. And this will be led by Professor Ibi. Thank you, everyone, and have a lovely, lovely, lovely weekend. Bye for now.
to our Caribbean and African Targeted Health Improvement Program, CATHIP Health Hour. The Caribbean and African Health Network, CAHN, along with its national partners, are incredibly pleased to continue to bring to you targeted health and well-being education delivered by Caribbean and African doctors. These health hours are all about empowering, educating, and giving space to Black people so our communities can look after themselves better. Every Saturday, our Black GPs or consultants present on those health and well-being topics that affect you, your family members, and friends. Some weeks will vary and will include other panel members such as pharmacists, specialist nurses, and faith leaders. Our health hours cover a range of topics and include mental health, heart health, women's health, reproductive and sexual health issues, men's health, respiratory problems, cancer, sickle cell, and many more. We have not forgotten to include within our health hours the many societal, cultural, religious, and racial challenges that can go hand in hand with health problems and influence how we should respond to meet health and well-being needs. The sessions are designed for you, and we want you to use the time to listen, learn, share your experiences, and ask questions to our Black doctors. During every session, we will gather your feedback so we can continue to respond to the needs of our Black community. To request any particular topic, please email health@cahn.org.uk. We encourage you to invite others to our health hour sessions. Spread the word in our community. CATHIP is funded by the National Lottery Community Fund.